Welcome everyone to this webinar on getting started with AngularJS. My name is Maurice de Beijer and I'm one of the developmental instructors who teaches, amongst other courses, Angular, Modern Web Dev and related courses. If you want more information about the courses, I suggest you go to the develop.com site and you'll find things right there. So a bit about my background. Like I said, my name is Maurice de Beijer, also known as the Problem Solver. I'm a Microsoft MVP, also an independent developer and part-time developmental instructor. Twitter handle MauriceDB, my blog's probably a bit long, but everything I blog also ends up with my Twitter account, so that's easier to spot. The most important thing about this webinar is tomorrow morning I'll post up all the slides and all the samples I've got on the web, and I'll put a blog post out and you can pick that either from my blog or from Twitter, and I presume we'll be mailing this out to all registered attendees as well. So what are we going to cover? Well, what's Angular? I'm going to assume that people have not had any prior experience with Angular, so we're just getting started with the basics. And then I've got a number of the more interesting subjects on Angular. So we're going to take a look at directives, which serve different purposes, but one way you can use them is basically to turn your markup into a domain-specific language. It's also, if you want to use jQuery or something like that with Angular, it's where your jQuery would go. So a major extensibility point. We're going to take a look at routing or creating single page applications using Angular, how you set that up, how you can use those. And we're going to take a look at services or how you work with external things like REST services, things like that, and also a bit about services as reusable code inside of Angular. If you want to take a look at the demos, I've got most of the demos ready and they're online. So if you go to bit.ly/dmanglerjs, you'll come to this site. And basically, the basics is empty, because I'm going to start that from scratch, but all the other demos, like about HTTP services and stuff like that, are already here for you to take a look at. But I'll go through those as well. Part of the source, most of it is actually already online on GitHub, but I'll put the remainder up tomorrow, so that's another place where you can actually find it. So what is Angular? Well, Angular is an MVC framework for building applications inside the browser. So MVC, Model View Controller, but unlike ASP.NET MVC, this is not running on the server, this is running completely in the browser. So we're downloading JavaScript, markup and CSS styles into the browser, and then everything is happening in the browser. It's become very popular over the last year. It's actually been around for a while. The 1.0 release was in 2012, about a year and a half ago, but it's in preview mode before that for, well, probably 2 years or so. So it's been available for quite a while, but it's really the last year where it really took off. And currently we're on 1.2.10, which was actually released, well, yesterday, I believe. So we're getting quite frequent updates. My samples still use 1.2.9. I haven't had a chance to update them that fast. So I said Angular is a framework. It's not a library, which is a big distinction between other things. Like if you look at jQuery, it's a library. The main difference between a library and a framework, you call into a library whenever it suits you. You just download jQuery and you use whatever part of jQuery you want. Maybe just one small function, maybe a whole lot. That's completely up to you. And you can combine as many libraries as you want. Like you could combine jQuery with underscore and maybe Bootstrap, something like that. With a framework, it's more of an architecture style. A framework calls into your code and it's is much more focused on a specific goal. So Angular is focused on CRUD applications, so it's really data oriented and really suitable for creating data entry forms and manipulating data, validating that, saving that back to the server, etc. Now, if you want to build a game, say the next version of Angry Birds or something like that, it's perfectly possible to do it with Angular, but you won't get a lot of benefit out. You might get some, but it's really not its intended use case. Another thing to keep in mind is search engine optimization. All the markup is normally rendered on the client. We're basically downloading templates, data through REST services and JavaScript. And on the client, we're combining that into our actual markup the user sees. Now, if your site is being hit by, say, Googlebot or Bingbot, it downloads the static content there, but it never actually runs your JavaScript, so it never actually sees the result. Now, there's some ways around it. There are ways where you can actually tell it what's going on and get it to do a reasonable job of indexing your site, but there is a lot of extra work there. So for public-facing websites where search engine optimization is important, I probably wouldn't be using Angular. Now, that said, it's of course perfectly possible to start with a public-facing website where a part is indexable and searchable through Google or Bing. Suppose you do an online bookshop like Amazon. Well, you want all your books, etc., to be searchable and people to find them through Google and Bing. But once you get to the shopping basket, well, that doesn't need to be indexed. So it's perfectly possible to create a static site for a large part of your application and then do specific things still with Angular. But it mainly shines for more in-house applications where it's not publicly visible, search engine optimization doesn't matter, etc. Another important part about Angular is its declarative nature. A lot in Angular is done by adding custom attributes to markup or even creating your own markup elements using directives. And you can do a lot with relatively few declarations, which makes it much easier to create applications and wire things together. And of course, it's well supported on all modern browsers, all modern versions of Chrome, Firefox, Safari, Opera, etc., i.e. work fine. In fact, 1.2, the current version of Angular, works fine in IE 8 and above. That said, there is a discussion going on about dropping support for IE 8 in Angular 1.3. As far as I know, that hasn't been finalized, so it might not happen, but that is the current plan. Now, IE8 isn't that popular, so it probably isn't such a big deal, but it's something you need to be aware of. So some of the key features of Angular. Well, it's a model view controller architecture, so it's a well-known design pattern. It's been used in lots of different environments for many, many years. Lots of developers know it, so that's good. It supports two-way declarative data binding. In an MVC style architecture, the model is your data, the view is actually what the user sees, and using, well, declarative data binding, you can set up the data binding between the two. It's rich with templates. You can create templates which are repeated, inserted, etc., different ways of doing it, also very nice. Now, those first three features aren't that special. Like, MVC is very common both on the server and in the browser. Two-way data binding is also quite common. Templates is extremely common. Some of the things which are less common are things like dependency injection. On the server, dependency injection is relatively standard. Lots of people use it, and it makes it easy to decouple different classes from each other, like create classes with a specific goal, and the dependency injection will wire up dependencies at runtime so things will work together. In the JavaScript world, that's a lot rarer. Quite often it's just a matter of, okay, you include JavaScript files, add references, things will get loaded, things will be available through some global name, like with jQuery you use the dollar or jQuery, with Angular there is the Angular object, but other than that we prefer not to use global things because it makes things very hard to test. Well, Angular actually contains dependency injection. It looks at your declared dependencies and it will inject those automatically, which means that it's very easy to do proper separation of concern, and that's very different from most other JavaScript libraries and frameworks out there. And this, of course, results in ease of testing, which is important. And in fact, the last point states, AngularJS is built with testing in mind. It's not like, okay, we've got a lot of JavaScript now, let's write some unit tests for it. No, it's built with testing in mind. Every decision the Angular team makes, they basically look at how can we test our stuff and how can we enable developers to test. So the last key feature of Angular, which is also kind of special, is directives, where you can create your own widgets. You can create directives which do a tiny thing, maybe add some kind of click handler to an element. They can contain complete snippets, and it's actually something which we'll see a lot more of in the future. There is a new standard being worked on by the web standardization committees called web components, where you can basically wrap up complete components in a reusable way. The way that works is different from Angular directives, but the goals are the same, and I presume in the future that Angular will actually move towards web components. That hasn't happened yet. We're not that far with web components, but we do already have that same capability with Angular directives. So if we want to get started with building an Angular application, the first thing is we have to bootstrap Angular. Like I mentioned a few slides back, Angular is not a library. We don't load it and then decide, okay, let's call Angular here. It's a framework. It takes over control. And we basically tell it when to start. Well, in order to do that, let's take a look at this little page, which I've got. It's pretty much an empty page. There is some markup here because I'm using Bootstrap, but there is a little script blocked where I've pre-populated some data, but there is really nothing else. Now, suppose I wanted to turn this into an Angular application. There are two things I have to do. First, I have to load Angular itself, which I've already got here, so let's drag the Angular reference in. This will take care of Angular being loaded. Now, if I run this, nothing will happen. I've already got this page open, so this is the site. If I go here, we actually see a little error, which I wasn't expected. I think I've got something left somewhere. There shouldn't be. Oh, right. Turns out I left some code in and I was already bootstrapping my application without wanting to. This is where I wanted to start. So I've got Angular, but nothing really happens. I'm just loading things up. If you wanted to bootstrap your application, you add an ng-app attribute. Now you can do so right on the HTML level. You can also do so somewhere closer inside your application. So I could, for instance, add a div in here and in here add the ng-app attribute. Basically, I've said that this div and everything inside of it will be part of an application. If I add it right at the body level, I'm basically saying that everything in the body is part of an application. You do that however you see fit. The one thing to keep in mind is you can only have one ng-app attribute on a given HTML page. So if this is an application, well, everything has to be inside here. You can't add the second outside. For that reason, it's actually relatively common to see this, say, at the body level or some pretty high level. But if you're only using Angular in a tiny part of your application and there is a lot of other stuff going on which is unrelated to Angular, then it actually makes sense to add it somewhere closer to where your application is, so it doesn't bother checking the rest of the HTML for Angular directives. Now if I can save this and refresh my page, we really don't see a difference. Okay, it's an Angular application running, but I'm really not doing anything with Angular, so there isn't much to see. So let me remove this for a moment so we can actually see what happens if it doesn't run, and let me add an Angular data binding expression. So there are different ways of doing it, but double curly braces is one. And expressions can be simple things like this. We'll see different examples. But basically this is an Angular data binding expression which says add 1 plus 1 and show me the result. Without the ng-app attribute, this will literally just render the output. So no Angular running, it just displays, oops, let's go back there, what I want. Now let's put ng-app back in. Now if we refresh my page, you see we actually get two here. So the expression was evaluated and the curly braces with the expression were actually replaced by the result. Now doing something like 1 plus 1 is not very impressive and not all that useful. I can do some more complex things here, but not terribly complex. It's like I cannot go and new up a date object here and do stuff. That's beyond the capabilities of these expressions, but that's really not what they were intended for. So let's go and take a look at some of the things we can do. First of all, MVC. Angular is MVC, so the M stands for model, which basically boils down to the data we're going to work with. The view is whatever is the rendered output, so the HTML, the markup we're generating. And the controller is basically the glue between the two. So pretty much any time you start doing things with Angular, you start creating controllers. Now there are different ways of doing so, but really the simplest way of creating a controller is just use a constructor function. So add a function, and let's disable caps lock. Lowercase function my controller, and in Angular it's relatively common to suffix controllers with CTRL. If you want to use the full controller keyword or just leave it out altogether, that's completely fine. Angular doesn't depend on it, but it's kind of like a convention. Create a function like that. Let's put a little not an alert, let's put a console.log in here. So the controller, so we can see that it's created. Now if we want some markup to work with a controller, we can basically add some element. Let's add a div in here and put the ng-controller attribute on there. Controller. And as the value, specify the controller name. So this ng-controller attribute says, okay, go and initiate this controller, my controller, and this controller controls whatever is inside this div. So I can put stuff in here. I will in a minute. Now, unlike an ng-app element or attribute where you can only have one, you can have as many controllers in a page as you want. They can control their own markup, they can be nested. You can do pretty much whatever you want, add as many as you want. The only restriction is they have to be part of your ng-app. You can't put them outside your ng-app because that's not part of your Angular application. So if I refresh, the HTML is not changed because we haven't done anything, but over here you see that the controller is actually instantiated. Now if we wanted to share some data with our view, we'd need a way to communicate between the controller and the view. So the thing Angular provides for us is a variable called $scope. Basically, we just put it inside our controller function, And Angular will use its dependency injection and will basically see, okay, there is something called $scope there. I know about that, and it will take care of $scope being added. So instead of this message in a console.log, we could say $scope.message, like this. So now it's added to the scope. That by itself won't make it visible yet, but now using data binding we can make this visible. Add the message. So inside your view you don't use $scope. All the expressions here are rendered against scope. So it will basically look from, okay, is there a message property available on the $scope for this controller? If yes, show the result. So now we should see the result show up in the markup. And it does right here. Now this is still relatively simple one-way data binding, but we can go further. Suppose I've got an input element. Input, if I can type that is, input type text. And instead of specifying a value here, I'm going to tell Angular that I want two-way data binding. So we use another Angular directive, an ng attribute, ng-model, and we specify what we want to bind to. Well, in this case, the message. If I refresh the page, you see that the message shows up in the markup, but also in the input controller. And if I start making changes to it, both are updated. So you see that data bindings are completely active and live, and the input element updates the underlying data, and the output binding, the one-way binding, just displaying the text, will automatically bind to that. All of that with pretty much just a few attributes. ng-model for two-way data binding, or the curly braces for one-way data binding. There's actually another way we can do one-way data binding. Let me add another span here. There's an ng-bind directive. Bind, which basically does the same thing as this message expression. So our message will show up twice now. You see the controller shows up three times, one in the input control, and if I type all of them stay exactly in sync, no problem. So why two ways of doing it? Well, if your page runs slowly, then these expressions actually show up before Angular gets a chance to compile everything and display the actual parsed expression. So this might result in what they call a flash of uninstalled content. If you use this syntax, which is slightly more verbose, but you won't have that problem, because before Angular data binding actually kicks in, you just see whatever is the content of the span, which is empty. You could put something in there, of course, if you want to, but if you leave it empty, that's exactly what you see. So you get a very nice data binding behavior. So those are some simple examples. But these examples are actually somewhat wrong. They work, but they're a bit too simplistic. There is a rule about ng-model, and it's a general rule of thumb, but you should always follow it. Ng-model should always contain a dot. The reason is that scopes are prototypically linked to each other. You can get many scopes for controllers and directives. They are linked. If you read from a scope, it will go down the prototypical chain, but if you write to it, it will always write to the object where you're writing to that scope, which means that if you're reading something for which is actually inherited through the scope chain, which happens quite often with directives, you might actually be changing another object than you really think you are. On the other hand, if there is a dot there, it means you're reading a property and then writing to a property on that object which you returned. So you're only reading from the scope, you're never actually writing directly. So a better way would be to do something like model is, oops, not model value, just model, and turn this into an object. Let's see. Now, this would be model.message. Same here. And the same over here. So, this way we've got a much safer way of data binding. Right now the result will be exactly the same, we won't see a difference, but in a more realistic application you're bound to run into a problem with nested scopes where things will behave. And the typical thing you see is that you're updating and it seems like your data bindings are broken. Some of them update, some of them don't. Well, that's typically because you're not using the trick with a dot in your NG models. So a model in Angular can be any plain JavaScript object. I just created a simple JavaScript object and that's all you need to do. There is no requirements like there are in some other libraries, like if you're using Knockout for example. Oops, my Windows is complaining. If you're using Knockout you have to use observables and observable arrays. Angular isn't picky about that. It basically says you create objects, you create data binding expressions, we'll watch those objects and we will take care of change notifications, etc. Which means that our models stay really simple. Like I've got some other objects here, a person with a first name, last name property, an array of people with a bunch of people in there. Well, all of these would be perfectly valid models. So I can actually move these into my controller and add them to the scope as well, and then I can start data binding to them. Scope dot, oops, no space. Person is person, so it shows up on the scope, and the same with people. So they show up in the scope and we can data bind them to them. For instance, suppose I wanted to start editing the person. Let's put that below here. I can basically just grab this, say person.firstname, person.lastname, and person.lastname. And now, for instance, if I wanted to display that person's full name, I could go in here and say person.firstname. And string concatenate that, for instance, with person.lastname. Refresh the page and we see my first name, my last name, the concatenations. Make any changes and things will just update. Nice and simple, and it makes creating data entry CRUD style applications really simple. I also had a collection of people. Well, we could also use that. There are lots of these attributes. Directives are called in Angular terminology, which you can do things. All standard directives from Angular start with ng dash something, but you can add your own. And suppose we wanted to bind to a list, we can use something called an ng repeat. So suppose I wanted to show that list of people, I could create an unordered list. Inside that create a list item, and basically in here I might say I want to do the same expression, but instead of doing this for a single person I might say let's do this for an ng repeat. Person in people, which basically says go and look at people, iterate over it, so repeat this template for once for every item in people. well, there are five people here, and go and print out their first and last name. And if I refresh, you basically see those items being printed out. And of course, oops, all data bindings, etc., still work. You see, even though this one is in a list, it's still being updated because it's really the same object being used there. So these kind of data bindings are real easy to do, real easy to use. So the view is our output. I basically just used the view, added directives to it. Remember, all the stuff you add to the controller, to the scope, is visible. I've used a few directives here. There are far more. You can create your own. But even with these basic directives, you can do some pretty interesting work. We'll see some more in a bit. Of course, the controller is the glue which glues everything together. Right now, my controller was real simple. It just added some properties. It basically just created some data out of the fly. But in a more realistic scenario, this would probably go to some REST service, get some data there, display it to the user, let user edit it, and then trigger some save action. So the controller basically glues things together, go and get some data. It doesn't normally, with a good design, it doesn't itself get the data, but it defers that to some RESTful service, which does the actual HTTP request, but the controller initiates that. It sets up the model, tells the view to bind. It will react to user events, things like that, for occurring in the view, and do whatever it needs to do. So that's the controller's kind of job. Of course, a controller can only do so much in isolation. That's why I already mentioned they typically initiate other calls. And all of that is basically wrapped under the umbrella term services. Services can be pretty much anything you want to, which is reusable in a code sense of way. Just like directives are reusable in your markup, services are reusable inside our code. Some services will do HTTP requests, other services can maybe store things in local storage, other services will take care of routing and those kind of things. So there are plenty of services, and I'll show some more examples on how to use them. One thing you can also do is start grouping services and controllers into modules. And as soon as you start doing that, on your ng-app attribute, you actually specify the main module to use for your application. And modules can take dependencies on each other, basically saying, okay, well, this module depends on module X, which has services Y and Z, etc. And they might depend on yet another module. And the whole thing will be wired up at runtime, providing Angular can find everything. Now, one of the nice things about Angular is if it can't find part of the dependencies, the whole thing isn't created. It basically breaks down right at the start. So the chances of having those vague errors where your application works mostly, but in one area, if you click on a button, there is something which was forgotten to load and that doesn't work. With Angular, that can still happen, but in most cases, you'll find that if you're missing something, those dependencies show up right at the start, and it's right when your page loads. It's clear that nothing works, and if you look at your console, the developer tools console, you'll typically find what's the missing thing, and you'll, oh yeah, I added a dependency on something, but I forgot to add the actual JavaScript reference in my page, so it didn't work. So it doesn't prevent those errors, but it makes them a lot easier to spot and makes life easier there. So some of the standard services are things like $HTTP, which lets you do HTTP requests. Or if you're using a RESTful server somewhere, there is actually an even nicer one, which is $resource, which I'll show in a bit. $location for getting current path on the URL, etc., used in single page applications. There are promises using Q for asynchronous work if you have to create promises yourself. Of course, $HTTP is already promise based, but you might have to do more yourself where you can use $Q. Route provider is one used to create the configuration for a single page application. Where logger, there are many, many services, including quite a few which just wrapped standard browser things. Like there is a $window, which wraps the standard window object, but in such a way that's injectable, so it's easier for testing. There are things like a $interval, which basically wraps the set interval call, but in a way that that Angular is aware of things going on and react to that. So I already mentioned the fact that all of this is wired together using dependency injection. Now, if you're using a strongly typed language like .NET or Java, dependency injection typically means looking at the type. You typically look at the constructor. It declares parameters of specific types, and then the dependency injection framework figures out how to create instances of those types and inject them. Of course, in JavaScript that doesn't work. We're not specifying types. We've just got a parameter name. There is nothing about types. So that doesn't work. It turns out that Angular actually uses the name. It basically goes to the function definition, looks at the actual names there, and uses those to inject things. So in my controller, I had a dependency on $scope. Well, Angular actually looks at that name, sees, okay, there is something called $scope there. It knows about $scope, so it can inject them. If I said, well, I don't like that dollar, I just want to call it scope, well, Angular doesn't know about scope, so it can't inject it. The same is true with your own services and directives, etc. All of those are injected by name. But that does mean we've got a bit of an issue, because typically in production, our code is minified, which changes names. Like $scope might actually just be called S, because it's a parameter, so it's a local name to that function. And the normal rules of minification say that changing that locally shouldn't harm anything, which is normally completely true, except in Angular's case, not quite. So in Angular, we need to specify some additional information about how to do things. There are a couple of ways we can do it. Let's actually just look at another example. Not sure where I left that example. Depending on how you create your controllers, there are different ways of doing it. One way is to create a variable called $inject. That just points to an array, and in that array we basically take our parameter names from here, but pass them in as strings. So now, if minification says, well, that scope can be renamed to S because it's a local variable, this won't change because it's a string. Minification doesn't change strings. So Angular takes a look at the controller, sees, is there a $inject variable set up? If so, use that for the naming. If not, use something else. In other cases, you actually specify an array by wrapping your controller or directive, etc., in that array, and your controller or directive is the last element there. The previous ones are strings with dependency names, which fix the same problem in a slightly different way. We'll see that in several examples, like this dependency injection example. In this case, you see I've got an Angular module here, my app. I created controller, DI controller, and I've got an array here saying I depend on scope and my dialog's a string, and then a function with the actual names. Of course, in this case, I'm free to call this whatever I want, because Angular will look at this. And the same is true in the other file, etc. Now, this is a bit tedious to set these things up, but that's the way you have to do things in Angular if you minify things. There are some utilities which can help you, like there is an ng-min task which you can use with grunt, which will, for the most part at least, figure out your controllers and other dependencies and inject these for you. But it isn't foolproof, it doesn't catch every case. And once you get used to it, it's not really hard. It's just one of those things you have to do. Otherwise, everything will appear to work fine in a debug environment, but as soon as you minify for a release environment, it stops working. So some of the standard directives, we already used a bunch of these, like ng-app. You might notice that when I was using them in code, I did them with a dash. I did ng-app, all lowercase, and in documentation, they're actually camel-cased, ng and then uppercase app. Angular actually allows us to use different naming conventions inside our markup. For instance, ng-app would not pass through the W3C validator because it's an unknown attribute, so you can prefix it with data dash and be HTML5 compliant. It will pass validation and Angular will still understand it. But that's the reason these names show up slightly different than when you use them inside your markup. So we used ng-app, we used the bind model repeat. There's some other useful ones, like ng-click will basically set up a click handler to let you react to something, and you can actually pass in data, etc. So suppose in my simple example I wanted to react whenever the user clicked on a person, I could basically say, well, let's add an ng-click here. Call the clicked function, and we actually wanted to know which person was clicked. Well, I can just pass in this person object, and now I can go to my controller and basically add that to the scope. Clicked is function, and now add some behavior to this. Like, I'm not just gonna log it to the console. Go back here, refresh the page with the console open, and there's the console. Now if I click on an object, you see the result actually being displayed. You might notice there is an additional value here, $#key, which is something Angular internally adds to keep things separate. That's all these things with $$ or sometimes just a single dollar are things Angular adds. Typically double dollar means it's something private to Angular, you shouldn't touch it. Single dollar things are actually quite commonly used as well. Other useful attributes like hiding, showing an ng-if for conditionally including markup. Ng-hide will hide things, but the markup's still there, data binding still work, etc. An ng-if will actually completely remove it if whatever expression is there evaluates to falsy. If you want to learn more about these, the AngularJS.org website is actually quite good. If you go to develop API reference, and assuming it responds, there it is, you see a long list here of attributes like ng-show. There's pretty decent documentation about how it works, what it does, and things like that. So ng model right there, which we use for two-way data binding. So it shows here, use it with input control, stuff like that. I find that in general the Angular documentation is not perfect. It certainly has room to be improved, but it's pretty good. It's certainly, for open source projects, not bad. Let's actually look at a slightly more advanced use case of controls and directives. Right here I've got a little similar list, but if I click one, this actually shows up an editor and basically lets me go and change things, and if I hit save, it's notified, and you see over here the name of Maria was actually changed to something else. All of this is very easy to do. Let me show the code. Directives, there it is. So the markup is slightly verbose because of my using Bootstrap, but basically you can see the ng repeats like I did before, the ng click which I used, the curly braces data binding, the ng form in this case, there is an ng show set to an expression current person, so if current person is Truffy, it will actually show up, which is done inside my application. Simple people controller, current person is null, so falsy, which means that the editor doesn't show up, populating it, and basically in the method where I'm clicking, all I'm doing is setting current person, and that will automatically display the edits fields and populate them and everything. And in the alert, I'm just picking up that person, displaying it, and setting the current person back to null, so the editor displays no longer. Really simple to do and really straightforward to write these kind of things. So custom directives are a really nice extension. They let you do lots of different things. Some of the more important things are including templates. You can basically replace long blobs of markup with templates and keep your code much more readable. You could, for instance, create a template called user editor and just bind that to a user and have a very short HTML page. But the user editor would actually use its template to create a complete edit form, which might consist of a number of rows with label input elements, which could be another template being rendered through a custom directive. They can also contain code. It's basically a place where you would set up event handlers or start manipulating the DOM, things like that. Basically something like an ng-click attribute sets up an event handler for a click and just calls whatever you want. So the common saying is, if you want to use jQuery with Angular, directives is where your code goes. Now it turns out that that always happens. By default, Angular uses something called jQuery for its DOM manipulation, which is a stripped down version of jQuery. But if you include jQuery on your page before Angular, it will actually take the full blown jQuery and let you use that. So it makes it really easy to use jQuery inside your directives. Let's take a quick look at some examples. I've got a directive example here. Well, the output looks exactly the same as the previous example, so let's take a look at the code. Custom directives. Well, same kind of markup as before, so what's the big deal? Well, we could actually replace all of that markup with just this. So let's comment out this whole div. Replace it with another one. Basically setting up a controller and then saying, okay, use my person editor in here. Go back to the page. And it still does exactly the same. No difference whatsoever. So what does that do? Well, the directive, where is it? Over here, my person editor basically says, okay, go and load up a template, and that template in here is my person editor. Basically says, okay, create a form, but create two different label text input field combinations, which in turn is another template, this one, which loads up this file, and that basically says, okay, it's a form group, so this is the Bootstrap way of saying we've got a label and an inputs element. And of course you could add much more to that. But if you look at this, either this code or all of it above, well, this is much clearer. over here there's lots of stuff. You have to go and hunt through all the diffs and labels and spans to see what's actually going on. Here there is a lot of intent. Okay, we're editing a person. Which one? Well, that one. What should we do when we hit save? Well, execute that function. What does an editor person look like? Well, we're editing two fields with a label in front of it, and we've got another snippet of code for actually adding a button, etc. So it's much more separated, much easier to use. An example on how to add jQuery code. Where was it? Right here at the top. I've got a directive called myFocus, where I'm using something called a link function. And the link function actually gives you a reference to the object being used. It can actually say, okay, go and set the focus to this element. So this is how a jQuery focus call would be included. Relatively simple to do. The main thing with jQuery is you no longer search for elements, so the CSS selectors are out. You add an attribute to an element, so you get past the element, and then you start doing your jQuery things with it. Let's close these windows down. Very nice, and one of the most powerful features of Angular. Also one of the features which has a relatively steep learning curve because of its many different use cases. I found that in general the use case of, or the learning curve I should say, of Angular is pretty relaxed. It's pretty easy to learn Angular and start doing stuff. It's only until you get into things like custom directives that the learning curve gets steeper. So another common use case of Angular is creating single page applications, which basically means that we navigate to a single page, and after that everything is done inside of that page. The actual URL on the address bar of the browser might change, but if we look at the network traffic, we see that even though it changes, we're not actually navigating and loading things from the server. So in a typical SPA application, you load your markup in your JavaScript once. After that, you only communicate with the server by loading and posting data back to the server. And everything else, the data binding, rendering different templates, etc., is done on the client, which means that a lot of interaction is a lot faster, because no round trips to the server. And of course, that means that our server doesn't get a lot of load, because all the stuff we traditionally do, edit something, post back to the server, server renders markup, sends that back to the browser actually renders that, goes and loads scripts again, hopefully from the cache, but might not be the case. Well, all of that's gone, it's just loaded once, and after that the server doesn't see much at all. So doing so through Angular is really easy. Let's first take a look at the running example. So, routing. We see a little list of people again, just like the previous example. And if I click on one, we see the name. Now, if you look at the URL bar, it actually changes. If I hit cancel, you see that we're now on default.html /people. If I click on the person, you see it's /person/someid. I can get another one. I can use the back button. I can use the forward button. So all the normal navigation works. However, if I open up my network tab, and over here we'll see all the networking requests being done by the server. See, there's no request going on. Hit the back button, forward button, nothing at all. So is there never anything being done? Well, let's go back to the main page, clear this, and go back to routing again. You see that initially we load up markup, CSS, Bootstrap CSS, we load up Angular and things like that. We load up templates. Somewhere along the line, data would have been loaded. In this particular example, it actually has the data embedded into the controller, so it doesn't do any loading of data, but otherwise we would get a little call here. So let's close that down and let's click on a person. We see one additional request. It loads up that editor template. So close this, cancel out of here, go to another. Nothing. The two templates being used are loaded into memory and all of the stuff is done locally. Saving doesn't actually save back to the server, so we don't see network request. But that's typically where you would normally see a network request. So what does it take to build something like this? Then the routing sample. The markup is pretty simple. There isn't a whole lot. This div is just basically the header, so forget about this. This is basically, well, in reality, just this line is the main markup for our page. So this has a new attribute, ngView, which comes in with routing, and that basically marks this div as the placeholder to start rendering templates based on routes. So where do the routes come from? Well, in my application, at application startup time, I've configured it, basically the module which I've bound my application to. I basically say, okay, give me the route provider. And when the route is /people, use this template URL and this controller. Small templates can be embedded here, but that's a little harder with more complex templates. So in that case, it's better to put them inside a different file. But you can actually embed them inside your markup as well as invisible script tags. So they wouldn't even have to be loaded from the server. So I've got a second route here, which basically say, okay, when the route is /person with :ID, so basically grab whatever's after that and populate that as a route parameter ID. And if the route is something else, do a redirect to /people. So if I type in any other route, it will basically redirect and show me the list of people. So this works with a little service, which is the normal way of doing these kind of things. And basically says, okay, go and get the people. Just so happens that this service doesn't actually go on the wire, but typically this would go on the wire to an HTTP request. And when I click on the person, fire the select method, which basically, okay, go and change the path to person/ID, which triggers routing. So now we're moving to this second route, which has another controller. And basically it looks whatever is the incoming ID from the route. Okay, get that specific person. And in this case, I'm actually doing a bit of copying because I'm doing everything locally in memory. Otherwise, I might change things and I can't undo. But that's purely a side effect of how I do stuff. So basically, I just get the person, data binding occurs, and in the save, I would save it. Again, here I'm doing some copying. Normally, you would post back to the server, and I'm changing the location back, and the same in the cancel function. That people service here, which is actually injected, is this thing which just has a big collection of people here. Real simple to do and real powerful. So the templates were actually in here, just like before. An ng repeat over all the people to get the list, and the editor basically has a bunch of markup saying, okay, go and create the input elements, etc. Just like before. So all very easy to do. And there are a couple of services used, like the route provider for configuring things, location to actually change the route or ask for the current route, and route params, which will actually tell you about the parameters defined in a route, like with /person:ID. The ID was the route parameter which we retrieved. Of course, you can have as many as you like. So use route params to get to all of those. Of course, we want to do AJAX calls, like an application that runs in the browser is a little isolated, a little limited. Of course, you could persist data using IndexedDB or local storage, but if you never get anything out of the browser, it's going to be a pretty limited application. Well, the basic service Angular provides is $HTTP. $HTTP is basically the gateway into AJAX request, do any HTTP style request. So there are some convenience methods like $HTTP.get. Go and do some a GET request. If the other thing returned can return things as JSON, that's a preferred option, and otherwise it will just take whatever it can get. If you want to save data, use a put or a post and things like that. Now all of these are very asynchronous. All AJAX calls in the browser are always asynchronous, so Angular is no exception there. And this is where it uses the queue service under the hood to provide promises when things are complete. So let's take a quick look at the example, HTTP services. You see here a list of people, but now you actually see a request being made to API/people here, which returns this collection of people, but now from the server. So we're actually calling it to a web API server right now, but that's more of a coincidence. And if I click on the person, just like the previous example, we see the person appear, but now let me clear the network for a moment. If I hit save, we actually get a message, but we see we actually did an HTTP put request back to the server. So what does the code look like? Not very complex. We're back to just having a simple page. So we've got like one of the first examples, our ng repeat for the peoples, our form bound to the current person, only visible if one set. Our app has a controller just like before, except now it takes a dependency on $HTTP, so it can do requests. So in here you see one of those requests. Basically ask for API/people, which will return a collection of people back. So whenever it succeeds, the success callback is fired and our data is populated. There are different callbacks you can use depending on what you're interested in. In this case, I'm not interested in errors, so I've only used the success callback. But you can also hook up the error callback, etc., and see when things go wrong. So basically, this starts off with an empty array, nothing there. Then the data is loaded. We actually replace the people. the people array on the scope with a new one which does have data, and as we've seen, data binding kicks in and displays everything. Saving the same, we basically use the HTTP put, send the request back to the server, and just like before, in the success callback, we actually set the current person to null, and after that we display a little alert that we were actually saving the person. Of course, this being asynchronous, this will actually display while the request is being sent to the server. Only when the request is done does this happen, etc. Now, this isn't very hard to write, but there is still a bit of HTTP boilerplate code here. And there is some stuff here which you really shouldn't put in a controller. So in that respect, it's not a very good example. Like if you would want to unit test this controller, you would basically have to take care of the HTTP traffic, the asynchronous behavior. In this case, we're connecting up to a standard ASP.NET Web API RESTful style controller. So the way it works is very predictable. Yet we have to write these out, and of course in a real application you also have to take care of error handling and things like that, etc. So it works in that regard, there's nothing wrong with it, but from a programming design perspective it's suboptimal. So let's take a look at a better way of doing it. If we go to the next demo, the resources service, it looks and feels exactly the same. Behavior is identical, yet this is much simpler. Let's go and take a look at the code. Resources. The markup is identical. No changes there. The controller, here's the controller, is much simpler though. it doesn't take a dependency on HTTP, it takes a dependency on a people object. That people object exposes a query method, and we just assign that to people. Now, people is actually a wrapper for a resource which is an HTTP request, so query is asynchronous, yet we can still data bind to it directly. What actually happens here behind the scenes is this query method returns an empty array, and then when the success callback fires, it will actually populate that array, so pushes all the persons returned into this people array, and data binding will actually update everything as needed on the fly. So that's a little smart from querying. So how hard is it to set up one of those objects? Well, real simple. This is all the code we need. Basically, we take a dependency on $resource, which is the Angular wrapper for HTTP RESTful resources. And we get $resource, which is a function. We basically point it to the URL we want to, API/people with the parameter of an ID. Add an update method to it so we can actually save it. This will create the whole definition for us. It's simple as that. So when we're saving, we're actually using the function here. Keep in mind it's called $update. So it basically takes this name here, update, puts a dollar in front of it and adds that to every object. So you can just tell an object to go and update itself. Real simple to use, and actually a lot easier than just using $HTTP. The only thing to watch out for, you need to take a dependency on ng-resource, and when I just said the markup is completely identical, I did lie a bit. There is actually an additional script file being loaded, angular-resource. The previous example just used the core Angular library. That's because resources are loaded through a different library. But that's a small price to pay. So that was the $resource library. So before I go to the questions, let me show one last demo where I've basically combined all of these things together. I've got custom directives in there, I've got routing, I've got $resource, etc., which is this combined example. You can see from the network request that we're doing a minimum. We're just getting a few templates and getting an individual person. You can see from the URL here in the address bar, we're actually doing single page navigation. It's changing, but you see we don't load more than just people. Let me clear this again. Now you see all we're doing is loading data. If I save, we'll see an HTTP put request. There it is, sending the change back to the server. Pretty simple to use. It's here incomplete. So the markup is like the routing example, where we basically have this ng-view element as the placeholder. The app sets up the routing. We've got controllers.js with the two different controllers being used, again taking a dependency on a people resource, which is defined in here, the person resource, sorry. It was taking dependency on people because I skipped over one thing. Basically, inside my routing, I told it to resolve that and actually do the query. So my controller doesn't even know about the querying. Basically, all it knows about people coming in, not how we got to them. The custom directives with the templates are there, so all of that just works. So the person list, like before, the person editor, with just like before, label input text combinations, that markup. So this is basically how you combine all those things, and with pretty minimal code. There's here a bit of information about routing, not a lot. Pretty simple stuff in the controller, really focused to what it does. The list controller, really has very little. The only form of logic in there is what should happen when you select someone. The editor controller is slightly more complicated because it offers a choice between canceling and saving. And it has to realize that if you save, that we actually, on success, have to reroute back to the list. Directives we've seen, real simple. In this case, we only use one. Resource we've seen, which basically wraps up all our HTTP traffic. So this is something which makes me real happy. I do this day to day, write these kind of things, and it just keeps a big smile on my face at how easy it is to do to create pretty nice applications. I've even got some animations in here. Like you see, things are not instantaneous. There is a nice animation which was added by where's the default HTML, by adding two things. First of all, descriptor, Angular Animate, and a small bit of CSS. Basically, this reveal animation shows how things show up and disappear, which is actually defined in here, the last part. Hardly very complex. So lots of goodness, lots of stuff I really like. I've been using Angular for pretty much a year now. I'm really happy with it. I'm gonna keep on working it. We're writing a complete course on Angular for Developmentor at the moment, which is already available on the website. So I hope to see you there. Now, I'd like to open up the floor for questions, if there are any. And let me see if I can resize this window so I can read the questions. Kathy, what happened? Cancelled? I'm not sure, but she has left. Does AngularJS mix well with third-party control libraries such as Kendo UI? How would I bind to a calendar widget, for instance? Well, most of that's actually done through creating custom directives. Now, in the case of Kendo UI, you don't actually have to go and create custom directives. Some of the people at Telerik and some other open source developers have done that for you, and I've actually used those in applications, and they're pretty nice to use. You'll find lots of other directives like that. For instance, if you want to use Bootstrap in your application, there is a project called Angular UI, which basically has wrappers for lots of Bootstrap things. So you include all the Bootstrap styles, but you don't include bootstrap.js, the standard Bootstrap file, which is basically jQuery code. They've got their own replacement for it. If you need to do other things which aren't readily available, it's basically create a directive, overwrite the link method there, which fires whenever data binding is first triggered, so just before data binding is triggered the first time, and there you actually get to play around with your object. You can set up event handlers for UI events, for changed event, things like that, and then you move data from that control back into the Angular world. Show the URL for the source code. Yes, let me pull up that slide quickly. Where am I? Wrong window. There it is. Let me move this a bit so things are visible. So this top is where the demos are running online. The bottom is where most of the source code is already, except the first demo, which I coded up on the fly, and I'll add that there tomorrow. Thank you, Maurice, for the wonderful webinar. Well, thank you. Can you please share the solution with me so I can play around? Well, as you can see, it's available both in runnable form, which is hosted on Windows Azure, and in source code. It's a Visual Studio project, so it does presume you've got Visual Studio, but other than that, you can go and play with it. Do you have more details of the course you mentioned? Yes, let me show you. If you go to develop.com, it should be right on the home site. Featured courses, let me move this out of the way a bit. Right here, Essential Angler. Let me make this fit together a bit better, like this. Basically over here it describes the course. So angler introduction, services, angler Ajax calls, data entry, routing, and I guess something went wrong here with copy and paste or code pages or something like that. Something we need to look up. Building custom directives and a lot about testing, which I actually kind of skipped over. I've got an example here, sorry, not this one, this one, of how to create a Jasmine test. Pretty easy to do. But all of that's covered in a lot more detail, of course, in this course. Now, if you want to know more information, just enter your email address here and you'll get notifications. Does AngularJS help to make mobile web development easier? Yes and no. Angular doesn't have any specific tooling for web development, for mobile web development. It does, however, make things easy because you just set up your data binding, etc., and you can do whatever you want with the markup. Like, I typically use Bootstrap these days for my UI. Bootstrap 3 is responsive, so it will resize things, and Angular doesn't care about it. All it cares about is data bindings, etc. So I basically code up my views in a Bootstrap way, and all of that works. Now, one thing to keep in mind with mobile processors tend to be somewhat slower, and you want to be easy on the battery there, not run the battery to ground. So you have to be somewhat careful with how complex you make your application. If you make it really, really complex, lots of stuff in there, it might run slow. There are some cases with data binding where Angular's change notification can cause it to be relatively expensive. But other than that, it works perfectly fine together. And I've done that, used applications on iPads and Android tablets, etc. Works perfectly fine. Well done, Maurice. Thank you, Jerry. And thank you, Eugene. Would you mind sharing your email ID for any questions? No, that's no problem. Let me type it in here. MauriceDB@develop.com. So that's my email address. I'm not going to hit the subscribe button because I'll subscribe to my own course, but that's where you can reach me. Have you encountered any memory leak issues or low performance issues with Angular when you work with large applications? Well, there are cases where data bindings can become slow if you watch for lots of things going on. One of the things on the scope is you can set up watches for changes, where the Angular change notification will basically notify you. Those can be on complete object graphs. Like, you could take an array of people and watch for any changes on an array. Now, if that array is very large, or the whole object graph in there is large, that could potentially become slow. And these watches tend to be called often. It's basically whenever something changes and Angular thinks data binding needs to be updated, it will evaluate all of those, update all the bindings. After that's done, because bindings can have side effects and change something again, it will reevaluate all bindings to see if any changes were made. Well, if you make changes there, it will actually trigger a re-evaluation, and it can do that up to 10 times before it will actually stop triggering that. So that's something to be careful with. Of course, mobile devices with lower speeds, etc., that's something to keep in mind. Other than that, I've found Angular to be really fast. It's all of the stuff happening in the browser with modern browsers is extremely fast. No problems there whatsoever. Thank you, Harry. And thank you, Eve. Is Angular your current web development tool of choice and MVC your pattern of choice? Think of ASP.NET and MVC or Knockout and MVVM. Yes, Angular is my current tool of choice. I'm currently doing Angular development all day. It's evening here in the Netherlands right now, and basically I've been coding up Angular controllers and directives all day today, all day yesterday as well. So yes, it is the main framework I'm working on it. That doesn't mean that ASP.NET, ASP.NET MVC is gone. I still use that because I find that the combination is especially powerful in more complex applications where I'll render views dynamically, and in some cases I'll actually render JavaScript dynamically using ASP.NET MVC Razor views. Beside that, I typically tend to use ASP.NET Web API for my RESTful services. Personally, I prefer that nowadays over Knockouts. Knockout is pretty amazing, but Knockout is good at one thing. It's a library for data binding, and it's really good at that, but it doesn't do anything else. So use Knockout for your data binding, then you want to do a single page application, you have to start looking for a routing library. Well, use SAMI, use Director, there are enough out there, but you have to go and search. You need to do DOM manipulation, okay, add jQuery to the mix, add jQuery plugins. So you tend to start mixing up different technologies, and for the most part that works perfectly fine, but occasionally you run into cases where some libraries will work fine in isolations and not together. And with Angular you don't have those kind of problems. That said, Angular has its limitations, and of course not everything in Angular is as perfect as it could potentially be. Thank you. Any debugging related recommendations? I tend to use Chrome as my default browser, and the F12 development tools in Chrome are actually pretty good. I tend to use those for most of my debugging. Of course, the testing capabilities, the ease of testing means that I can do a lot of test-driven development, well, where I just write unit tests and run those. And what I'm actually using is the Karma test runner. Karma Test Runner, which is basically a Node application which runs on your desktop, and it will basically watch the file system for changes to JavaScript files and then reload everything, run all the tests and report. Thank you, Quinn. Another question, can we use other JS frameworks like XJS along with Angular on the side? To be honest, I'm not that familiar with XJS. I know about it, but I've never actually used it, so I don't know if that would work. In general, though, you tend to choose one framework because a framework determines the architecture of your application, and it tends to be somewhat uncommon to use different frameworks together. Far more common is to use Angular, the framework, with other libraries, like include jQuery for additional DOM manipulation capabilities, include underscore for its functional capabilities, include Kendo UI for its UI controls, things like that. That's much more common. So it's possible XJS would work. I can't really tell, but if you describe it as a framework, I suspect it won't. So that seems to be the last of the questions. I'll give it 1 minute or so to see if additional questions show up. Okay, two more. Thank you. Well, thank you for attending and asking good questions. Like I said, tomorrow I'll bring up the slide briefly again. All the codes will be up on GitHub. The slides will be up on SlideShare on my blog. I'll put a link on it. The developmenter will also send out links to all of that. And feel free to play around with it. I'll leave the Azure site running for quite some time in the future, so you can play around with that and have fun. Enjoy Angular.